As I was watching the kids scamper out, I noticed that Kylie, true to form, I can't keep shoes on that child. She was walking around barefoot. I'll blame that one on her mom. Convenient, since she's in there, not in here. So this morning, I want to start off by talking about this guy right here. Some of you who follow SEC football may have seen him in the past. You may know exactly who this is. In 2010, National Signing Day for Athletes came about in early February, and it was the day that athletes all around the nation could officially sign and send their letters in to their respective universities to tell them, I'm going here, you're going to be my coach, I'm going to be your player. And a South Carolina native by the name of Marcus Lattimore was about to make his pick. And he was going to sign his documents, binding him to his school. But what was so unique about him is he's one of the most highly recruited players ever. I think of all the players that you see of scholarship offers go this place and that place, he had something like 100 scholarship offers to go play football. This guy was absolutely fantastic. And he chose to enroll at his home state school of South Carolina and play for Steve Spurrier. He quickly became a sensation. I think it was by his second game he had rushed for already 200 yards in a game. As a true freshman, he was just a quick hit. He was destined to find his way into the NFL. His freshman year, the entire year, he was just a really good player. But his sophomore year came around, and he got cut short by what appeared at the time to be a very gruesome knee injury. And as that goes on, you start wondering, is he ever going to be the same back? Is he ever going to play the game with the same zeal and passion for it again? But he persevered, and he came back stronger. He came back better. And his junior year, he seemed to be well on pace so that he could go off to the NFL after the year, have himself a wonderful career, and leave South Carolina as the best running back to ever play there. But I remember sitting in a chair, getting my hair cut at the Sports Clips up the road, and watching as the unthinkable happened, and his knee was destroyed again. This is one of those moments where I jerked forward in the chair, didn't matter if they were cutting my hair, didn't matter what it was going to look like. It was sickening. And everybody wondered, is he ever going to be able to play this game again? He eventually decided to declare for the NFL draft. He went in the third round. He rehabbed. He got back in football shape, but he was never the same player again. A promising career was cut short due to injuries, and he now coaches football at the high school level. During the pre-draft process, though, I was very interested in his story, because you see players play on the field, but you never get to know who they are. And so one particular interview stood out to me. He was with John Gruden, a Super Bowl winning coach, and he was being asked, about these times when he was injured and what it took to come back from these injuries and how this all played out. And one thing that he said impacted me to this day. On my laptop, I've got a sticky note, a digital sticky note that says this quote. When asked how he dealt with all of this, he said, adversity introduces a man to himself. Adversity introduces a man to himself. I've often thought about that statement. I've tried to put it in the context of different situations that I've gone through, that I've seen other people going through. And this morning, I want to try to put that quote into the greater context of what's going on in the shape of our world. Let me start by saying this. The world around us is horribly broken. Throughout human history, less than 8% of recorded history has shown the world to be completely at peace. Today, wars exist in the Middle East and in Africa. Cyber warfare is happening in Europe, Asia, North America. People are fleeing from drug cartels in Mexico and corrupt governments in South America. Kids are sold into slavery in the Far East. Paints a pretty grim picture. But our own country, if we take a smaller view of things, it's just as broken. Racial injustice, economic difficulty, mass shootings, deep political divides, and anti-Christian sentiments grow out of control. And if that weren't enough, the church has a brokenness all of its own. Pastors resigning over serious sins. church bodies splitting over petty, insignificant details. Some shutting their doors altogether because they haven't seen a new member in 30 years. False doctrines are being preached and the gospel is ignored. Brothers and sisters, when Marcus Lattimore said, adversity introduces a man to himself, welcome to the adversity. This is the world that we live in. Let's find out if we can introduce ourselves to the real us. It's easy to grieve for what is broken, but what I've found is that I no longer grieve. It's easy to stew in anger at the treatment of Christians, but I find I no longer hold anger. It's easy to get depressed over all the injustices, but I no longer feel down. It may sound weird, but I actually feel excited. Not because bad things are happening, but I feel excited because whenever you read through the scriptures, whenever you look at history, what I see is that God shows up in these times. If you spend the time to study it, what you're going to find is that God seeks revival. He's not going to sit there and let these things sit and simmer for generation upon generation. What he's going to do is allow things to get out of control so that we will turn back to him. If you look at the book of Judges, you'll find this phrase repeated over and over. In those days, Israel had no king and everyone did as he saw fit. The original plan for the people was that there would be some sort of a theocracy. For those of you who don't know what that fancy word means, it basically means that God's in charge. He's going to be the one that runs the nation. No king would be necessary because God would be a direct link to his people. And in those times, God actually did respond yes or no with yes or no answers to questions through a process of the Urim and the Thummim. And I think I've brought this up before. We don't know exactly what it is, but we know that he answered. But when we read this phrase that in those days Israel had no king and everyone did as they saw fit, I don't think we fully understand what it's saying. When we read that phrase, it doesn't simply mean that we're before the time of the king, where Saul would come in and try to unite the nation through the political means. It means more than that. It means not just that there is no physical king. It means that every man and woman became a king or queen unto themselves. And God was pushed out of the picture altogether. In fact, Judges 3:7 says that it is more than pushing the Lord out, but they actually forgot the Lord. Forgot him completely. Sounds a lot like today. So God chose not to hold back the surrounding people anymore, those who would come in and persecute them. God chose to remove his hand of blessing. And what would eventually happen is they would come in, be taken over, be persecuted, and then you would think that that would be the time that we grieve over what's going on. But I think the way that the Bible is read, it should be a time of excitement. Because that's the time when God shows up and says, now that you have turned back to me, I will raise up for you a judge and he or she will deliver you. Much the same happened during the time of the prophets. In 2 Kings chapters 22 and 23, we read the story of King Josiah and how the priests who were doing some repair work on the temple rediscover the books of the law. And Josiah, he has it brought to him, it's read aloud, and he realized that the Jewish people had for generations forgotten who God was. And not just forgotten who the Lord was, but they'd even gone so far as to lose the law. But the Lord put it upon Josiah's heart to experience revival in his land in his time. And the worship of the Lord was reinstated. The Baals, the idols were all smashed and destroyed. And revival swept through the land. At least temporarily. You skip forward a little bit into the Middle Ages, and there's atrocities that occur on a daily basis in the religious realm. It was very, very real. Enter Martin Luther and his 95 Theses. He sought to bring back the church from the depths of despair that it had sunken into. And it started a movement that eventually became called the Reformation, because people were so eager just to have the truth of the knowledge of God, to have the Bible read in a language to them and preach to them so they could understand it. And what we could look at in history and say it was horrible times, we can instead look at and say, God revived the people in Europe. Skip forward a little more to the American Civil War. During the first year, it's described as people basically losing their minds, a time when bloodlust and hatred abounded. Nobody was safe. It didn't matter if you weren't a participant in the war. You were fair game. And yet, the preaching of the Word of God brought soldiers back by the hundreds. Little churches couldn't hold the numbers of soldiers desiring to hear a word from the Lord. The revival spread so quickly that baptismal services sprang up on the banks of rivers and lakes and ponds, and they would stand around for hours just singing and praising and baptizing, all while under constant enemy gunfire. Let me just get that through your head for a moment. They sang for hours while being shot at because there was genuine revival going on in the lives of those soldiers. Thousands upon thousands died in that war, and yet thousands upon thousands came to know Jesus in the midst of the struggle. Today, how can we view our world as being in any less turmoil than any of these situations I've talked about? How can we be any less excited to hear God's words preached? How can we be any less excited to see people turning back to Him again? This is the adversity in which we live. And it's time to find out what role is within us for God to work through. Every time a great revival has occurred, it seems to bring about great change. And I know that word, it seems dirty. It seems like it's that one of those four-letter words that you can't say, change. But the 1960s brought about the last great revival that we can point our finger at in this nation. And one of the things that occurred is that people from all different backgrounds started experiencing God for the first time. And so what we would call contemporary Christian worship music sprang up out of that. Before that, there was no sense of this newer style of music. But what happened is people of the 60s, there was a different sort of music that the people of that time liked, and so they brought the lyrical side of things with them. And now all of a sudden we've got songs which some people love, some people don't, but what I've come to understand is that while they may not hold the same deep theological value that some of our great hymns like Amazing Grace might, they hold enough passion and love for God in them to make it all worthwhile. There's a simplistic passion about it. For the Lord behind those repeated lyrics, I can't tell you how enamored I am to see people singing them, how encouraged I am to hear people singing them, not because they hold such great significant theological value sometimes, but that there is a simple faith behind it. It reaches a different audience. When the judges came, changes were made to walk more closely with God. When Josiah found the book of the law, changes were made to ensure that God was properly honored. When the exile ended, changes were made to ensure the people would never stray towards the idols again. Church, revival, the way God wants it, genuine revival is going to require change. Within our hearts, within our body, and within our community. Because it's God's plan to bring people back close to Him again, both the churched and the unchurched. Which means that we must heed the warning that Paul gives us in Colossians chapter 2 about clinging so tightly to our traditions that it creates a barrier to revival amongst people who need it. I've been to discussions recently where we've talked about looking at changes in the way that we do this worship service. Nothing concrete yet, but discussions are happening. Why? Because revival is needed. I've been in discussions about changing the way that we reach out to our community changes. I've been in discussions about the programs, the ideas, the studies, all changes. Not changes that compromise the truth of God's word or the need to worship Him, just changes that will work in concert with what God is seeking in His creation right now, at this very moment. Revival. Can you flip that forward for me? There we go. And this is something that we have to be actively involved in. For too long, Christians have kind of ceded their responsibility to God's kingdom to the political process. Church, I'm going to say this one time. We cannot ask our government to legislate morality. We cannot partner with God to transform hearts and souls if we wait for the government to do all the good works for us. I wish we would take the approach of ignoring the political process as it relates to godly matters. You want to complain about rulings that go against our morals and our teachings? Well, guess what? The only way that changes is revival in our communities. Revival is the only true way to set this nation back on the path to the Almighty. That means we can't keep doing the same tired things and expect different results. Isn't that the legal definition of insanity? Pointing towards revival means getting a little creative, because let's be honest, Satan has certainly changed up his attack plan on how to trip us up. He'll do it on a daily basis if he needs to. It means not being sticks in the mud that lead to yet another lost generation. Church, if one soul in our neighborhood is bound for hell, I believe it's a personal failing on each and every one of us to have not found a way to reach them. Our Lord seeks revival that burns true within each of our hearts and also in the hearts of those we're going to be ministering to. The Lord seeks people to genuinely turn towards Him. And this picture right here, this is one of those efforts. This is something that is really cool. This happened in Waco, Texas. Back in the mid-90s, a group of people came together and they wanted to reach out to the homeless community. And what ended up happening is they started with a small group and they began ministering to them. Then all of a sudden, they went and got their homeless friends. Over today, this church has an official website, official small groups, official worship services, all still under the very bridge in which they met their first homeless person. And they lovingly refer to themselves as God's trolls living under the bridge. God is working in that city in unique ways. He's working to reach the lost and to bring our country back to Him a little bit, right there in Waco, Texas. Church, I say all this because Glenn arrives next week. He wants to come and be our new preaching minister, and he's going to come with ideas and passions and a fire and zeal within him to teach to us and present us the truth of God's word. He's also coming to do his part to jumpstart this community right outside these doors, back here behind us, into a revival so that our community and the revival that starts within it can spread to the entire ends of the earth. But let me reintroduce you to the adversity before us and all that we endeavor to do. Jesus tells us in Luke 10, chapter 10, verse 2, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few." Church, a revival is not something that we attend under a tent. It is something that we partner with God to accomplish for His purposes. And church, we can ask God to do things all day long. But ultimately, we are His voice. We are His hands. We are His feet. We have to do it. Not every soul is going to embrace the Lord, unfortunately. But there's no excuse for us waiting for them to walk into this building to introduce ourselves and to engage them with the good news of Jesus Christ. Adam read to us from Isaiah 53 this morning, and that is the full good news, that He came on our behalf. The world needs to hear it. It's time for a revival in this body. And church, let me tell you, revival can be messy. I don't want to gloss over this fact. Revival, genuine revival, will push our limits. It's going to test our traditions. It's going to draw us to our knees in prayer. And it's going to force us to seek guidance from the Spirit. But is there any more true expression of the Great Commission than to seek out revival for this body and in this community? It's time that we as a church begin to embrace that old Nike slogan, just go do it. I think Trey was who told us about going as you go to do this Great Commission. Church, it doesn't matter how you do it, just do it. If you can do it through a bowling league, go to the bowling league and talk to those people that you're bowling with. If you can do it through playing with Legos, well then, go play with Legos. God just wants revival. Get creative with this. 1 Corinthians 3, verses 5 through 9. I want to read that again to you. What, after all, is Apollos, and what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God has been making it grow. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose, but they will each be rewarded according to their own labor. For we are co-workers in God's service. You are God's field, God's building. God's going to do the big part of the work. I promise you that. But he needs us to take up throwing the seed out. He needs us to take out watering the seed. He needs us to take an active role if revival is ever to occur in our nation, in our state, in our city, in our church body. This morning, I want to ask you, do you need revival in your own life? I can promise you that there's somebody in here who does, because I know that there has been times when I needed revival. And I had individuals who reached out to me and said, Mike, I want to help you through this. There's somebody in here this morning who needs it. And if you know that individual and that you know that they need it, reach out to them this morning. Don't allow Satan to grab a foothold. You're not alone in that. Do you need to take more seriously the calling to help revival flourish? Well, if so, it's time to ask God to take an active role in what you're doing, to push you and give you strength and courage, and to show you through the Scriptures what you need to know, what you need to see, what you need to do to make revival become reality. Church, this world around us is broken. Welcome to the adversity that we live in. But be excited about it, because the Lord is going to work through you and for you in order to make revival occur. This morning, if you are in need, this morning, if you need revival to occur within your life, we want to pray with you. We want to help you. We want to talk with you and study with you. If you know someone else who you're just finding difficult to reach out to, there are people here who want to help you with that. We will gladly take up and help you with that burden. Church, if there are people in your workplace, in your family, in your circle of friends who need revival, and you want to pray for them this morning, this is a perfect opportunity to ask God to take over the work that you are trying to do on your own. Church, if you are in need this morning of revival, I ask that you come as we stand and sing. Just as